Without further ado, it is my pleasure to welcome our speaker today, Zappar co-founder and chief technology officer, Conal Gourde. Conal, I will hand it over to you now for the reins.
Thank you very much, Joel. Hi, everybody. I'm super excited for this session, if I don't mind saying so myself, because today we're announcing something we've been working on for quite some time at Zappar, which is the next generation of our creative tooling here at Zappar. But before we go into too much detail about what that is, I'd like to set the scene just a little bit and have a little recap of our offering so far at Zappar. So our Zapworks platform has a number of different tools, two of which I'd specifically like to highlight in this session before we go into more detail about what's coming next. So first is our Universal AR set of SDKs. Now, those are where we've taken our computer vision technologies, those technologies that can track faces or images or indeed the world around you, and we've wrapped them up in a set of SDKs for different creative tools and platforms, and in particularly a focus on the web and web AR experiences. So for example, you might wish to use one of our Universal AR SDKs for 3JS, a 3D engine for the web, or you might use it in Unity or Play Canvas or a number of other different platforms. And then also at Zappar, we have our Studio tool. So that's our complete 3D development environment for AR, VR, and MR. So it's a downloadable application that you get onto your computer, and then you can drag in your models. You can build complex 3D experiences in a relatively simple manner and give them interactivity, give them animation, et cetera, from the comfort of the 3D development environment. So on the left with the Universal AR SDKs, you get something that's a bit closer to the technology, if you like. It's a bit more raw, whereas in Studio, you get everything wrapped up nicely into this 3D development environment. So if we have a little think about the advantages of Universal AR versus the advantages of Studio. Now, with Universal AR, because we're taking our libraries and SDKs and wrapping them up for other platforms, you can leverage the ecosystems that exist in those other platforms. So, for example, if you're using our SDK for JavaScript, you can use all of the JavaScript libraries, the NPM package repository, for example, all of that great JavaScript ecosystem value you can leverage when you're building your AR experiences using our Universal AR SDK. There's, of course, a huge quantity of learning materials as well that surround these other ecosystems, which help you to build AR experiences that work really well and use innovative new ideas from across those ecosystems. And so when you're using the Universal AR SDKs, you're building content using the tools and the APIs that you already know and love, or you're able to, as I say, with those learning materials, get up to speed very quickly. Also with Universal AR, you can leverage traditional content serving and hosting infrastructure. So if you're building a web AR experience with Universal AR, effectively you're building like a mini website or a mini web page. And because it is a regular, a standard web page, you can host it using standard hosting and serving infrastructure. Now, obviously at Zapworks, we provide a complete hosting pipeline that you can use if you want to. And for Universal AR, Zapworks is pretty much a traditional typical web host. So we operate and provide a service that lets you host this web page and this website through Zapworks as a convenience. With our Studio tool, you have this rich editor that makes it easy to design experiences. So part of that comes with a reusable component model. So if you're building pieces of content in our Studio tool in that nice graphical interface, you can build them as a module that then you can take and use in other experiences, or you can share with others in a way that's really easily and nicely encapsulated. It includes powerful animation tools like timelining and these sorts of rich mechanisms for producing animated content. We have a fully integrated publish and preview pipeline in Studio. So as you're building your content, you can just hit the preview button or the publish button, and then that gives you a code or a link straight away for you to be able to access that content. And it also abstracts around some of those eccentricities or bugs that exist in mobile operating system platforms, or just the kind of gotchas, like sometimes Safari operates in this way or Chrome operates in this way, particularly when these web browsers. Studio shines off those corners or edges so that it's an easy development environment and you don't have to worry about these different platform eccentricities. And above all, Studio provides this lightweight engine that ensures users get straight into content experiences. So when you build content with Studio, the associated code and engine that powers that is really lightweight. Users don't have to download a huge amount of an engine as part of viewing, say, a WebAR experience in order to get into that content. So with Universal AR, where I think it's fair to say it's very much more a code-orientated environment, in Studio, you have very much a more a graphical environment for building content. And as you can see here, it looks like we've got this kind of dichotomy of flexibility, despite being perhaps harder to use on the left with Universal AR. But we have the perhaps slightly more constrained situation, but much easier to use setup with Studio. And so what we asked ourselves at Zapper was, can we get the best of both of these worlds? Can we build tooling at Zapper that gets all of the advantages of our Studio development environment, but then leverage all of the flexibility, all of the ecosystems, everything we know and love about Universal AR, and have those all in one? And so we were basically thinking, can we make the love child of Studio and Universal AR? Can we make a sum of parts that is better than both? And so today I'm super pleased to be announcing our brand new content development tool, which at the moment we're calling Studio TNG. So it's a brand new creative tool and it's for building rich 3D experiences for the web, including AR, VR, and MR, so augmented reality, virtual reality, and mixed reality. Now I should say Studio TNG, TNG stands for the next generation. It is a working title for us at the moment. Those of you who are Star Trek fans may be disappointed to know that we will be choosing a different name for a studio and announcing that ahead of a beta program, which we'll talk about a little bit later. But it is a little bit of a nod to Star Trek. So if you are thinking about building content, AR content, VR content, MR content in particular, then Studio will be of interest to you. In particular, there's a number of different users or different types of user, if you like, that will feel right at home in our next generation Studio tool. So if you're a Unity developer, a 3JS developer, or Babylon.js developer, or I suppose in general, a front-end web developer, then lots of the concepts within Studio will already be things you'll be completely familiar with. And we'll talk a little bit about that as we get into the details of what Studio TNG is and how it's built. But that's not to say you have to be a developer in order to get great use out of next-gen Studio. If you're a user of a no-code AR tool like Zapworks Designer, one of our other tools, then next-gen Studio might be a great way for you to elevate your experiences to the next level, including perhaps interactivity or perhaps integration with other elements of the ecosystems that we've talked about. Indeed, if you're a user of our current Zapworks Studio tool, you'll feel right at home in next-gen Studio. Lots of the concepts that we know and love from our existing Studio tool have ported into the new Studio tool in a really obvious and comfortable manner. And so you'll be able to port your knowledge into next-gen Studio really easily. But also, of course, then take benefit for all of that additional flexibility that you get from Next-Gen Studio. And we'll talk a bit about that, as I say, as we get into the details. But also those people that are perhaps developers on other social AR platforms, or perhaps creative designers or technologists, will also have plenty of to do in Next-Gen Studio. All of the concepts that you're used to in other platforms are exposed in there for you to play with in a way that's delightful and flexible. So it will be really interesting to see how people use the tool, and in particular, those that have used other platforms. So let's talk a little bit about the core structure of what Next-Gen Studio is. I'm going to go into a little bit of technical detail here, in particular because those who are developers or have a background in perhaps Unity or in web development will understand the benefit of some of these elements that we'll talk about. But as will become clear as we go through what we talk about here, the studio, for the most part, abstracts away the technical detail we're going to mention here. So if the concepts on this slide are maybe alien to you, if you've not encountered them before, you don't need to worry. For the most part, Studio will not expose you to these things. You'll be able to make great use of Studio using the knowledge you already have about augmented reality, or just, you know, the creative skills that you and us all learn as we use computers in the modern world. So without much more ado, let's talk about some of these core elements. So when you're building a project in Next-Gen Studio, you're building a normal Node.js package. So if you are a front-end web developer, you'll perhaps be used to a Node.js package. Front-end web developers build web pages and websites using a variety of different tools. And one of those tools is the Node.js and the NPM ecosystem. And effectively, that's how people who use React, for example, build web pages and websites. And fundamentally, behind the scenes, your studio project is a Node.js project in exactly the same way as it is for millions of other web-based projects that web developers in particular work with every day. And these projects utilize our Universal AR SDKs. So any development, any innovation that we introduce to our Universal AR SDKs will be available straight away in Next-Gen Studio because Next-Gen Studio is a consumer of those SDKs itself. Next Generation is a collaborative web application. So unlike our current studio, Next Generation runs in your web browser, and it abstracts away much of the complexity for building a Node.js package for the web. So as I say, these concepts of what a Node.js package is, it doesn't matter if you're not familiar with them, but if you do know what a Node.js package is, hopefully you, like us, can see the flexibility and the excitement that that then gives you as a content developer. What this allows Next Generation Studio to do is expose to developers a way to progressively opt into the complexity if they wish to. So if you are a developer who understands your package.json file or understands exactly how you would like your TypeScript configuration, for example, then with Next-Gen Studio, you are able to control that configuration and set up your development environment exactly how you wish it to be. But those who don't know or wish to worry about those details can just leave that all to Studio TNG and not have to worry about it. So you can, progressively opt in as you need to the complexity that you might wish to use or might have a requirement to use. And of course, while our focus at Zapper is augmented reality, the application will in fact be a great tool for building any 3D web experience. And we'll talk a little bit more about why that is. And indeed, in a little while, we'll have a live demo where I can show you some of the reasons why I think that would be the case. So going under the covers a little bit further, Studio Next Generation embraces and extends some of the web's greatest 3D technologies. So at launch, Studio Next Generation will leverage and support 3JS for 3D rendering. Now, 3JS is a fantastic open source project that makes it easy for web developers to build 3D content that runs in a web browser. And because Studio TNG leverages 3JS and extends it, it means we get a ton of great features out of the box. So a proper physically based lighting system, so your AR experiences are going to look fantastic. Dynamic shadows that enable your 3D content to react to the lighting in your environment and cast shadows on themselves and the other objects in the view. You can write custom shaders if you have a requirement for particularly fancy effects, for example. And 3JS has spec compliant GLTF support. So that means you can import into your project 3D models with confidence and expect and enjoy them being rendered really well within your 3D environments. And with that all said, we add that Studio TNG's rendering engine support is fully configurable. And what that means is, if you wanted, we could use, and we probably will in the future, support Babylon.js instead of 3JS for your 3D rendering environment. So if you are a developer that is used to one or other of these 3D rendering engines, you could choose to have a Babylon JS project in Studio TNG instead of a 3JS one. In addition to that, because Studio TNG's support for these 3D rendering engines and just in general support for libraries is fully configurable and extensible, if you have your own 3D rendering platform, then you could wrap it up for Studio yourself and get all of the benefit of that 3D engine and the component model and some other interesting bits that are part of Studio TNG. In fact, at Zapper, as we've been building support for building out Studio TNG and its features and functions, we've built it as an engine that or a platform that is agnostic to the 3D engine, it's agnostic to the AR engine, it's agnostic to all of these different elements. And then at Zapper, we've picked the libraries which we think work really well in 3D development environments, such as 3JS. And so, of course, we are wrapping those components in fantastic support within Studio itself. So if you're a 3JS user, you don't need to worry about wrapping up 3JS for Studio. We've done all of that before. But if you are a developer who likes using a brand new 3D rendering engine, then if you wanted, you could wrap that up for sure. So this is what Next Gen Studio looks like. Now, I should say that Next Gen Studio is 100% a work in progress at Zapper at the moment. So some of these things you'll see are likely to change or be a little bit different in the version that we ship. But for the most part, what you see here is what's working as a complete work in progress, but it is working in the browser at Zapper. So, and we'll see that during the live preview. But some of the things here you'll recognize, especially if you're an existing Studio user. So we have a 3D view in the center with some 3D objects. And on the right, we have a hierarchy of 3D objects and groups and elements that are part of your experience. And we'll talk a little bit more during the live preview, the live demo, what those things are. And then underneath, you've got the properties for those nodes that allow you to customize and edit your experience and build a 3D environment that you're looking for. There are a few other components there on the screen, but first, I think it would be great to talk about the left-hand bar here. So this is the project view, and it's the top tab on the left in Studio, and it shows you just the files you care about in your experience. So the assets that are part of your project, your 3D models, sounds, images, any script files that you've written to bring further interactivity to your experience, and component files, which are the element of reusability in Studio. And we'll talk about those in a minute. And other than that, this is a normal file system. So these are files that you can drag in from your computer to upload or add to your project if you like. You can rename them, you can add them to folders, et cetera. The project view hides some files, but the files view show all of the files that make up your project. So if you flip down to that view, you can see here that there's actually other files that are part of your experience. But for the most part, you don't need to worry about it. However, if you are a web dev pro and you want fine control over your project, these files are always here for you to tweak and to adjust and to get how you like. So you'll spot there that there's a package.json file as part of your project. There's an index.html file where you can completely control the appearance of the web page that powers your experience. There's an index.ts file, which is the entry point into your experience. So while Studio, as we said, has this progressive opt-in to complexity, that projects panel lets you see the bits that matter creatively to you. And the files panel lets you dig underneath to how it's being powered so that you've got that control. And you know, that's not just the difference between the projects panel and the files panel in Studio. This concept of progressive complexity, it's pervasive throughout the Studio tool. Studio, the next generation, seamlessly integrates with NPM. And NPM is a huge repository of JavaScript libraries and SDKs. It's a mainstay of front-end web development, but there are libraries in NPM for physics and for all of the 3D rendering engines we've talked about, lots and lots of other examples. And so Studio Next Generation, when you open your project, it resolves the dependencies in your project. So it looks at what NPM libraries you want to use And it does exactly the same process that npm install does if you are a front-end web developer. It does that all within the confines of the browser so that you can get the benefit of libraries from npm. In fact, if you're using Studio Next Generation and you're using, say, our face tracking or image tracking, our Universal AR SDK is just added to your project from npm in the same way it would be if you were installing Universal AR into a node package of your own. In that regard, Studio doesn't treat Universal AR any differently to the npm libraries that are the other dependencies in your project. But as I say, you don't have to worry about adding these projects to your dependencies. Studio comes with a set of projects that let you just get straight into the act of building a face filter or building an image tracked experience without you having to worry about choosing what dependencies you want. You just have the flexibility here to do so if you wish to. We've wrapped some important npm libraries in npm libraries of our own that help them to integrate with the Studio Next Generation user interface. That's to say that we've identified that if you're using 3JS, it would be great if it integrates fully with the user interface. And so we've done that for you. But much like we were discussing earlier, you can do the same for libraries of your own if you wish to. In general, though, any npm library that's being designed for use in the web browser should work. So Studio Next Generation parses the configuration files in your project. And we saw that a little bit a moment ago where we had, for example, package.json in that files view. Studio Next Generation understands the structure of these files and can present a really easy to use interface so that you can change those settings should you wish to. And you don't have to worry about the syntax of those files or how they work. But if you are, as I say, a front-end web developer and you know how those files work, you can just go straight into the files and do it yourself if you wish. A really important feature of Studio Next Gen is a fully hot reloading local and remote live preview. What that means is that as you're building content in Studio Next Gen, you can activate the live preview and either on the device you're building on or on a mobile phone that you have, you can scan the code and see the project as you're working on it. And in fact, there's two ways that live preview works. One way is that if you are as you are tweaking and making changes in your experience, perhaps you're moving a 3D model around or you're changing the material properties, if you're trying to work out how to get it to look right, as you're making those changes, the live preview on your phone can update in real time. So you don't have to keep reloading your experience. Everything happens seamlessly as part of that experience. Now, sometimes that's not what you want, although often it's really nice editing experience. But sometimes you want to perhaps be scanning and using a version of the experience and making tweaks, but continuing to use the version that you're working with on your phone. So there is a mode where only changes that are saved are then synchronized to your device. So there's a number of different ways of working with it, but it's all designed to make it really fast for you to iterate on content, to see how it looks in the context in which your users will be using it. There's also some really nice quality of life features with the live preview. So if you are on a device and you're scanning some content using live preview and you're accessing that experience, any debugging or console logging that you have added to your script or to your project gets sent automatically back to the Studio interface. And so you can see within Studio what devices are currently connected to live preview, what errors they're experiencing, or what console logs they're outputting. So you don't have to worry about attaching like Chrome debugging or Safari Inspector or any of these tools, although they're still there for you if you're comfortable with them and wish to use them. But for the most part, you can get all of that debugging logging data straight into Studio without having to mess around with wires and setting all of that debugging up. As part of Studio, we are implementing a first-class animation system. Now, if you're a user of our existing Studio tool, you'll be familiar with our controllers, states, and timeline system. Our concept with these tools is to make it easy to build animated experiences that have lots going on, different events cause different animations. Perhaps the user is playing a game whilst they're also rotating their device into a different orientation. In AR experiences, lots can be happening at the same time. And so our controller states and timelines system in Current Studio is all designed to make it easy for you to build animated experiences, to build complex timeline experiences in a way that animations don't conflict with one another, and you can build user experience as well as gameplay type functionality easily. We've taken all of those same concepts for into Next-Gen Studio, but we've added some additional functionality that gives you even more power. So with Next-Gen Studio, you have the ability to have blended animations. So multiple animations running at once where one animation blends with another. There's also the ability to edit things like just the X position of an object rather than having to edit the whole position of an object in a timeline. So lots of little quality of life improvements over a Current Studio implementation. So suffice to say, if you have used Current Studio, you'll feel right at home in the animation system in Next-Gen Studio. And indeed, if you're coming from a tool like Unity, you'll find that the animation primitives in Next-Gen Studio map really easily from the abstractions in Unity. And so you'll see things like animation clips being referenced. Lots of the terminology is similar, and lots of the implementation of what you build, you know, how you compose your timeline will be very familiar. So I thought it would be good to just give you a little live demo of what it looks like. So hopefully this will go well. Joel, do let me know if things can be seen.
Will do. Thanks, Connell, for that. I know people are quite pumped about the revamped animation system.
Nice. Yeah.
Personally, I think the live preview is really hyped because that's something where for anyone that's ever created something at all, you're always really conscious of what does it look like? And to be able to like see it in real time, I think it's going to be a huge time saver for everyone, especially.
So that's really absolutely. Cool. Even in you know, just in the building of Studio Next Gen, we're taking these libraries that are constituting the AR experience, like 3JS and what have you, and we are teaching Studio about these libraries. We're building components around these libraries, and in the process of doing so, I found that the live preview is the easiest way to do that. So I and my team, you know, effectively, we're front-end developers. You know, we're building Studio as a web application, and so our kind of common development environment is Visual Studio Code. You know, we're working with NPM a lot. We're working with all of these tools in building Studio itself. But in terms of teaching Studio about these libraries like 3JS and Babylon.js and what have you, I found that the Studio environment itself, with the live preview and the hot reloading, has been the most efficient way for us to do that development, if that makes sense, which is really heartening as a developer. You know, we have a vision for what we want for Next-Gen Studio, and then to find that we're wanting to use Studio to build Studio is a nice sign for us. Anyway, I've digressed.
Always a good sign to use our own stuff.
Yeah. Okay, let's have a look at a live demo. So I'm going to share my desktop as a whole, and let's pop through to Chrome. Is that coming through for you there, Joel?
Yep, that's coming through.
I'll maybe pump up the jam a little bit there so that we can see a little bit easier. This is featuring a light design rather than a dark design that we've seen in the slides so far, but both modes are available. As I say, the user interface and the user experience here of Studio is our work in progress build. And so it does stand to change and be improved as we work towards a release. But for the most part, this demonstrates all of the fundamental elements of Studio that we're talking about. So we have on the left here our project folder, if you like. So we've got some GLB files. These are 3D models. We've got our index.html and index.ts file, which describe the web page that our project exists in. You know, when we're expecting users who use Next-Gen Studio not to ever have to worry about index.html and index.ts if they don't want to. So for the most part, If you're a user of NextGen Studio, you'll be spending most of your time in the 3D view, working with the hierarchy and the object properties, and not having to worry about some of these more technical files. I can switch through to this files tab that we spoke about, and we'll see that inside this project, there is a package.json file. I can open node modules here because Studio has gone through the NPM install process. It's fetched all of the dependencies from our package.json file and installed them into our project. So we can look in and we can see 3JS is in here. TypeScript is in here. Zcomponent, which is our library that wraps up the different 3JS libraries, et cetera, is in there. But again, you know, very rarely would anybody ever have to go into the node modules folder, but it's there if you want to see it. So I'll pop back to the project page here. I'll do a little move around of the 3D view. So you can see it's real glorious, lovely, physically based rendering, all powered by the fantastic 3JS rendering engine. We can see here on the right, we have our hierarchy. So this 3D model, this of the helmet, it's a GLTF file. You can see the properties that are exposed by this this object, whether or not it casts a shadow. I can turn that off, I can turn it on. Position is there. Lots of properties for lots of different object types are possible. So what we see in this hierarchy are what we call components. So much like if you have ever used React or AngularJS, we have a component model in Studio. And what that does is it says, we want to take some functionality. It might be 3JS GLTF file. So 3JS is implementation of this 3D model. And we want to wrap it up in a component that means it's easy to add to this hierarchy. We can expose what the properties of that GLTF file are. We can tell the Studio engine, here's how you construct a 3JS 3D model. And we wrap all of that component functionality up and expose it to the Studio application so that instead of having to worry about typing out, how do I load a 3D model and show it on screen? It's literally just a case of right-clicking and going new 3D models GLTF. And as you add it to your experience, then you can see it appear in the 3D view. You can edit those properties, and you can add behaviors and interactivity and animations all within this lovely 3D interface. You don't have to worry about how these components have been implemented. In fact, if I were to go into another component in Studio, if I create another 3D view like this, so this is scene.zcomp, I could create another one, and then scene.zcomp itself is then a component that I can add. So if I go new here, I don't think it's would let me add itself to itself, if that makes sense. But for the most part, I can build a component of my own using the 3D view. I can build up a hierarchy of things, and then that component itself can then be used as a component elsewhere in my project. So perhaps I want to build a character with this helmet. I can build it all here, and then I can use it in other files. Perhaps I've got several other components for an AR scene, and I can say, I want the character here, I want the character here, I want the character here. I get this completely reusable modular component system as part of Studio. And it's one of the things that we have found really important, particularly with our previous Studio tool, is this idea of reusability, sharing of components, sharing of content, so that it's easy to reuse and to get the most out of the stuff you're building. So I thought I would on this screen show the live preview in action. So I have the setting set so that whenever I save a file in Studio, the live preview will update. If I pull out a little bit, this is not an AR piece of AR content. This is just a really simple scene with a 3D model. You can see that there's a camera here that's pointing at the model. I'm going to just drag this view over to the left. I'm going to hide that so that there's a bit of space there. I'm going to click this live preview button and open it here as a new tab. And we can see this is a preview. I'll just move it over here so that we can see it at the same time. This is the live preview of this project running. Now, as I say, it's not an AR experience, but you could totally imagine this would be a world tracked experience and the camera image would be shown behind and the user could place this helmet into space. But what I wanted to show is that if I make some changes here, let's say I rotate this around and I hit save, the live preview updates straight away. So I'll just undo that rotation and I'll hit save again, and the model updates instantly straight away in that other view. So the round trip time to make changes in your experience and see how they take effect in the actual version of your experience running on a device is pretty much instantaneous. So there's a tiny amount of latency between the 3D view and the live preview, and we put a lot of work into making that work really nicely. So let's close that live preview. And I want to show one other thing. So this here is a more complex example. Now, in this example, what we're doing is we're building a custom component. So we're saying that we want to build a component out of code, TypeScript in this case, extends or takes the possibilities of the content beyond what Studio currently provides. Now, most of the time, users of Studio won't ever have to do this, but for those that want custom shaders or want to build custom components that can fit in your hierarchy, it's 100% possible. And so I thought I would show it with that caveat that if it's scary, don't worry, you don't have to do it. But if you're like, oh my goodness, I can totally see how I could use that, then this is for you. So we have a simple project here with a sphere in the center here. And on the right, I have a TypeScript file that's just in my project. And what I'm doing is I'm calling this define component and I'm calling it noise material. What I'm doing inside this component is I'm saying, here is how to build a noise material. That's what I'm saying to Studio. And I'm writing the code to say, this is how it's implemented. And because I've used define component and I've added a few bits like this little annotation here, Studio knows about it and understands it. And when I right click on sphere, I can go new, noise material appears. So Studio has detected from my code that there's this noise material thing that I've created and knows that it's something that could go in a hierarchy, and so shows it in the hierarchy for me. So I can click that and a noise material appears here. Now, one of the things that is happening here, I've added noise material into my sphere. Studio has taken noise material, it's running all that code when it is showing you this 3D experience on the left. And this noise material, the way it's implemented is it uses three shader materials. So that's 3JS's way for you to make your own custom shader in GLSL. So it allows you to build your own materials effectively. And what we've got above in this file is the implementation of that shader. So if you're familiar with shader writing, this should all be straightforward to you. There's a fragment shader, there's a vertex shader, and we've implemented it into this view. We construct the shader here in our component, and we return it from our component. Components are just functions in Next.gen Studio, functions that can return an object with properties that can then be added or inserted into the hierarchy when your experience runs on your phone. That's all details that don't matter so much. The important thing here is we've constructed this shader, and even though we're in a development environment, Studio is able to run that code, that material, and show it rendering here on this sphere. So that the shader we've written describes this speckled noise pattern. We have some uniforms. See if I can find where it's defined in here. We have some uniforms in our shader, called one of which is called scale. So if you've not written a shader before, a uniform is a way of having a configurable variable inside your shader. And that your application, even though your shader ends up running on like the fancy hardware on your phone, the shader uniforms can come from the code that's running on the CPU of your phone and send like organizing the 3D rendering to happen. The important thing I want to mention is that we've got this property scale, which is one of these features or one of these variables that we want to run in our shader. We've written our shader so that scale determines how dense or not dense the noise is that's showing. And what we've done is we've wrapped it in a little bit of a comment here. And we returned that from our component, and that scale value goes into our shader material. all of these are technical details that don't matter so much. The important thing is that if I click on noise material, because of what I've told Studio about in my custom component, scale appears in the node properties as a really easy to use user interface. So let's say I'm a member of my team who loves writing shaders, is really keen to kind of push the boundaries in terms of materials and 3D rendering. I can build those components. I can wrap them as a custom component like this. I can expose the parameters, the configurable properties of the shader I want to provide. And I can provide that to other members of my team who don't have to worry about this code view or anything like that. All they need to deal with is the fact that noise material is now something I can add to my 3D objects, and I can use the nice configurable UI that the developer has provided me with. In addition, so using basically the same technology that Studio uses to power that live preview, when I'm building custom components like this, the component itself is on the fly, updated as I edit it. So I've got my shader here. This value here is the kind of red component of the image that's shown on that sphere. So I can just go like 1.0 here, and instantly on the 3D preview, the rendering of that object has appeared. So I can undo that. We go back to the noise controlling all the channels, can redo it, and it's straight away back to the modification with the red value. So as you can see, like, I can make these changes instantly, immediately. I don't have to be going round a publish or even a build process to see what they look like. I can do it really quickly. So let's just pop 0.0 here, 0.0 here, and we get just a completely red sphere without any of the influence of the noise. I can pop the noise back. So just a really nice, fast, tight way of building content. But as I say, most of the time, users of Studio don't even need to worry about that tab. Like, that functionality is there if you want to. Most of the time, people will just be happy to deal with the noise material that either is built into Studio or that colleagues provided them with the functionality for configuring it.
I love that. Connor. I think that's a great way to get more out of for people with like 3D assets that they're trying to make go further, just to put shaders on it and try different stuff with those little details. It's like a great way to get more out of them without having to kind of resort to getting more and more 3D models. I'm interested.
Yeah, absolutely. I think we are rapidly running out of time.
We are approaching time. Yeah.
Is it 1:15 that we finish? Is that the time that
So we've got a good 5 minutes. If anyone else has got any questions for the Q&A section, we've got one so far, $1 million question. Do we have a release date in mind for Studio TNG?
I'll answer that at the end if that's okay. I have a few, just one more slide, I think. Yeah, which is Studio TNG on a slide. I will rattle through this really quickly, but I have this because I want to make sure I don't miss anything about it. So what is Studio TNG? It's finally great 3D tooling for the web. So gone are the days, if you're building a 3D web experience, gone are the days of having to just script and code everything. Studio Next Gen provides a fully integrated 3D development experience. And it does so by just leveraging all of that ecosystem, all of those tools you already know and used to, and exposes them in a way that's delightful and fast to use. And if you're not used to those things, don't worry, Studio abstracts them in a way that means you don't have to worry about them. It features a comprehensive rendering engine, you know, in the first instance, powered by 3JS, which means access to all of those great features, the PBR rendering, dynamic shadows, custom shaders, all of these elements of 3JS available to you. It's, of course, a seamless scripting environment. So much like current Studio, we support TypeScript as the kind of primary first and foremost scripting language within Studio. It's very much like JavaScript. And in fact, I think it's a superset of JavaScript. So for the most part, you can just write JavaScript and it's valid TypeScript. But we use TypeScript because it helps us and developers using Next-Gen Studio to build robust experiences really quickly. Fully baked animation tools, which we saw, be super familiar to those coming from other platforms and will be a lifesaver for those that have been used to building animations using code. a vibrant ecosystem, the JavaScript ecosystem, including the NPM package repository and all of the amazing libraries that are within it. A real-time collaboration. So what I haven't shown is multiple people can be working on the same studio project at the same time, much like Google Docs or like Figma. The changes you make all are consolidated together, so you can really easily collaborate on an experience at once. Modularity as a first-class feature. So that's talking about that component system. So it's really easy to build segments of an AR experience or a 3D experience that you can then reuse across the same project in other projects, or you can share with your colleagues. And of course, there's that seamless preview, debug, and publish process that makes it fast to iterate on your content, and then of course to get it out there for people to try. So back to the million-dollar question. We are launching a beta program for NextGen Studio, which we expect to be in people's hands early 2023. So you can scan this code here. I think Joel's going to pop the link into the channel as well. If you register your interest there, you'll be first in line to get your hands on NextGen Studio, along with its chosen name in the beginning of the new year. Can't wait to see what you guys produce with it. And between now and then, we'll be looking to ensure that we've got all of those great features wrapped up really nicely in the studio interface. So it's fantastic and easy to use when you get your hands on it. So I think that's maybe us. It's just about in time.
Yeah, no more questions come through. So I think we're safe to wrap up there. I've posted the link in the chat. So if anyone wants to get on that mailing list, then don't hesitate to sign up. And thank you very much, Donald.
No worries. Thank you very much, Joel. And thanks, everybody, for joining.